Dear God, I just ask you that you allow me to speak a word that provides hope for your people. And while their ears be able to hear, eyes be able to see, and hearts be able to know the direction you desire for them in their life. Amen. Okay, so I don't think that there is probably a person alive who has not in some way had a part of their past that they just wished it never happened. There is likely that we have deep wounds from living life. There is not a person alive who hasn't struggled with some way of regretting some part of their life. You know, there's a saying that says, time heals all wounds. But I'd like to just tell you that that's just a saying. It sounds good, but like a lot of things that we say over and over, it's not necessarily true. God heals all wounds. And it has nothing to do with time. Time is a factor in the whole thing, but time in itself does not necessarily help the wounds of our past. Instead, it is because of God that there is hope found. To consider and decide a sermon series and something that will speak to the people that are sitting in the pews and offer them a direction in their life is pretty tough stuff. And I have to tell you, I was really struggling as to how to start out the new year in a way that offers hope to the situations in your life. I knew that hope was important, but I couldn't wrap my head around how to speak about hope in a new way. And then I saw a book by a pastor, his name is Pete Wilson, and I saw this quote. And it said, your past is not your past if it is still impacting your present. And I thought, you know what? I know that for all of us sitting here this morning, there is likely something that is in our past that we are carrying into our present and our future. So I'm going to ask you honestly this morning, what are you still carrying with you from your past? What are the unhealed stories of your life that you keep dragging into your future like a bag of rotten trash? I'm going to confess a little bit here that I have this kind of secret little pleasure. And what it is it's watching that TV show, Hoarders Buried Alive. It's a terrible show. But watching that show in some way makes me feel good. I'm like, oh wow, my house is really clean compared to theirs. And it does often inspire me to clean out the refrigerator or something like that. You see, if you watch the show, you realize that the hoarders, they can't see the horrific situation that they're living in because they have been immersed in it way too long. They become desensitized to the mess. And I thought, you know what? That is a perfect analogy for the junk in our life. That there's stuff that we no longer see clearly. We only see the bad results that come from dragging this trash along with us. But we've become desensitized to the initial problem that we keep pulling into our future. So I'm going to say that it's now time to consider how your past is not left behind. I can tell you with 100% certainty that we will transmit our gunk to the world and to those around us if we do not give God all of our garbage from the past. Because without transformation, and transformation is only comes from God, what happens is we transfer the pain that we have inside of us to everyone that we interact with. From your friends, to your family members, to co-workers, neighbors. What happens is we will create attention, we'll create suspicion and negativity and fear wherever we go, because we have not resolved the situations in our past. People who are in recovery know that well and work on that minute by minute, day by day. But it goes way beyond addiction issues. It goes to the hurts that come from all seasons and times in our life that have come and they've sneaked in on us and they've framed the way that we speak and we talk and we act and we react. And so the key to overcoming the past pain is making a choice to invite God's hope into your life. You know, and that's different than inviting God and being saved. Inviting God's hope is a stage step that there are mature Christians, people who have been going to church all their life, and let they keep feeling like they need to clean themselves up to come to God. What we need to realize is who we were yesterday does not limit who we can be tomorrow. But the only way that that transformation happens is if we allow God to change our life. God is bigger than your history. God is bigger than your biggest problem. God has a destiny for us. God has a future and a hope. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "I know what plans I am planning for you. I have good plans for you, not plans to hurt you. I will give you a hope and a good future." Jeremiah is a prophet. We know him as the weeping prophet. And in all his dissertations to the people of Israel, he's saying, "You're failing, you're failing, you're not letting God in. You've done this wrong, you've done this wrong. You have this problem. You're dragging all of your old stuff along with you." And then all of a sudden, he begins to wrap up everything. And what does he say? "You have hope and a future in front of you. So I have only told you all these places where you're falling short because I want you to have the best possible future." So you might ask, how do we move from the mess in our past to the future of hope and goodness? Now, I was reading about New Year's resolutions, and it says, you know, you can try countless resolutions, or you can say, okay, I'm gonna really dig deep into my faith. However, the tricky part is not making the resolutions, not saying that you're going to dig into your faith, but instead to make sure that these resolutions and whatever spiritual practices you're going to put forth in your life, that they're going to move you into something new. Because if it keeps cycling around in the same way it's always been, it's not effective for transformation. There's an author, his name is Richard Rohrs, and he writes about how religion doesn't necessarily move us closer to a situation with hope. He said, "Is your religion helping to transform your pain? If it is not, it is junk religion. We all have pain. That is a human situation. We all carry it in a big black bag behind us, and it gets heavier and heavier as we get older by the betrayals and the rejections and the disappointments and the wounds that are inflicted along the way. But religion itself will not move us away from throwing this big bag into the dumpster. We need God. So I ask you today, do you know what to do? Because when I got to this point in the sermon, I'm like, okay, this is really good. I've pointed out all this awfulness that we have in our life, but what do we do with this disappointment? What do we do with this sadness? What do we do with all of these things that have affected us in the past and that are currently affecting our present and future? And then our Bible study on Thursday nights is in Romans. And this week I look to the book of Romans and Paul, who had plenty of junk happening in his past. He writes, "I want to boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character, and character produces hope." That Paul is saying that we know that suffering is a part of humanity. It's happened from the moment they took that bite of the apple. Suffering was a part of what happens here on earth. But Paul is saying we can either get stuck in our suffering and in our pain, or we can use that suffering to move closer to God. It's not that suffering is ever good, but what happens is when we suffer, we actually are able to come alongside and draw closer to Jesus, because we know how much Jesus suffered. You know, we often think of Jesus' suffering just being the suffering that happened on the cross, but it was way beyond that. Jesus lived a life with people. He lived with people that would disappoint him, the people that would betray him, people that would fall short of the things that you would want from a family member or a friend. He suffered homelessness and poverty and hunger. And what happens is when we are able to come closer to Jesus because of our suffering, we learn something called compassion. And it is in that compassion first for ourselves and the situations that have happened in our past, but then it can move us to compassion for others. In this way, we can transform our own suffering into a compassion and a hope and a love for others who are suffering. In this way, our past transforms us to be more like Christ. The ultimate goal of a Christian life is to be more like Christ. And so what it is saying is that in your suffering, you will be able to draw closer to that goal of being Christ-like. I want you to just imagine for a moment, what would happen if you grew up with perfect parents and a perfect house and were a perfect student and you had all perfect friends? You went to a perfect church, you worked with perfect people, and you yourself was pretty perfect. What would you need in your life? Nothing. Would you need transformation? No. You know, we want to often think about the good things, and it's really good and healthy to point out the things in our life that are positive. But it is equally important to look at our scars, to look at our sufferings, to look at our pain, and to look at the imperfections in life, and then have a desire to change them. So I asked you this morning, what does God want to change in your life? So we'll look at it in two ways. First, our personal life. What does God want to change? What are the things that you are dragging from your past into your future? And then consider the ways that God desires to transform your sufferings. Because actually, that hoarding of pain is actually creating suffering. Maybe not for you, but I can tell you, probably for the people around you. Do we need to admit that our stubbornness is as a result of fear? Or our procrastination is about poor image? What are the experiences and the sufferings of the past that keep haunting you? In a moment of vulnerability, I think it's really important to look at what are the arguments that we keep having over and over and over again. I can tell you, for me, it is often an argument about saying, I'm sorry. I just don't like to say, I'm sorry. And I'm not a bad person, so I don't know why I don't like to say I'm sorry so much. But with a lot of reflection and a lot of prayer, I've come to realize that the reason I can't say I'm sorry, and the reason that I can't say I'm sorry, especially to those I love the most, especially my husband, is because it makes me feel like I am a complete failure. And because of that, I don't take it as it's just one mistake. Just say you're sorry for that. But it almost makes me feel too vulnerable. And it rubs against some childlike part of me. That it's a failure to not be perfect. It's a failure to make a mistake. Therefore, you are a failure. And so what happens is I drag this childlike fear throughout my life. So what can I do? What can I do about this experience in the past that I can't even necessarily label from keep haunting my present and my future? Well, the one thing is counseling. And often in church we get really afraid of that word counseling. However, often working through life situations with a professional can be life-changing. That God can use that to transform your life. And so, I ask you to consider that. The Greater New Jersey Annual Conference in the last year has trained hundreds of coaches. And a coach is a little different than a counselor. A coach helps you walk through your situation and then helps you come up with ways to be transformed. And so I know for myself that I have a coach, and this is something that in this new year, I'm going to work with my coach. And part of this transformation and part of the work with the coach is the fact that it could be just a one-and-done situation, or it could take just a couple times of working with them. But whatever it is, that this person is going to hold you accountable to not picking up that garbage bag out of the dumpster and bringing it back with you. For others, you would do well by joining a recovery group. We have AA, and we hope to have NA shortly here at church. We have also Al-Anon for family members of those who have addictions. Join a group that actually can again hold you accountable and move you through a process of healing. Or join a small group. Because we have started small groups here, and the idea behind a small group is to come alongside each other and partner in healing. No matter what your situation is, I am here to tell you that there is hope. But unless you're able and ready to open yourself up, there can never be change. In the same way that you need transformation in your personal life, we also need transformation as a church community. This day, Human Relations Day, is set because it is the day that the Sunday before the celebration of Martin Luther King Jr.'s to honor him. In a sermon on Romans 12, King acknowledged how strongly culture around us tries to influence us and pressure us to be like them. Just think about all the TV and magazines and internet and commercials. And think how much we are encouraged to spend lots of money that we don't have, or time on things that we really shouldn't be wasting our time on. How much the advertising is pointing to making yourself look like someone other than yourself, or acquiring whatever is the latest fad. Driving a big fancy car or buying the biggest house, even if you cannot afford those things. What King does is he paraphrases Paul's words, and he says, we must make history, not be shaped by history. Most people are thermometers that record or register the temperature of the majority opinion, not thermostats that set that opinion, that transform and regulate the temperature of society. We, the people of Simply Grace, can set the temperature for how we want the world to look. Too often the church has just followed society, and we have looked back and cried about our failures. Instead of following Jesus' teachings, we have allowed slavery and the Holocaust, matters of inequality, segregation, to just name a few. We do not want our children and grandchildren to look back at the church and realize that we too have failed. Therefore, we need to, as a church, open ourselves up to the transforming work of the Holy Spirit. Transformation often does not happen all at once. By my experience, I have seen both personal and community transformations, that it happens in a pattern of steady growth. So today, as we begin this time of thinking about what hope is and allowing hope into our world, allow this to be the beginning, our stepping out. I'm going to give you a moment, a short time of quietness for you just to kind of close your eyes if that's what you want to do, or leave your eyes open, whatever is best for you. And to begin the process of opening yourself up to to God's transforming work. And so I'm going to just kind of walk you through. Just take a moment and consider the things that really hurt your heart. Both personally and things that are happening in our world. Think of the things that cause you to cry out. Think of the words of your loved ones and how sometimes your actions create pain for the people that are around you. Lift these things before God and ask God to just open your eyes, open your heart, and open your mind to see what is the source of this pain and suffering? I ask you to just quietly commit to taking some steps toward healing and hope, opening yourself to transformation. I want you to consider to pray to continue this conversation daily with God. As you open your eyes, I want to share one last piece. In the hoarder show, when they, for whatever reason, need to clean out the house, they begin to divide piles into things that are trash and things that they might give away and then things that are going to keep. And the person who's the hoarder, they want to keep everything. And they're not willing to hand anything over. And without, it's very easy from us to see that if they don't hand over this stuff, their life is not going to change. I ask you in the time and during the week and then through the time that you consider giving up the things that you are hoarding, to remember that without giving things up, you will not change. And so remember that just as it is, you can't see the good in it right now, just like they can't see the good in it. I want you to have this mental picture that it is necessary. Let me pray for you. Dear God, I just thank you because I know you, that you are beginning a good work here, a good work that offers your people a hope and a future. But just like the prophet Jeremiah spoke out against the things that were not of you, that their people were holding on to, I ask you that you speak into each person's life and know, let them know what they need to let go of.